Now, co-writer, director of The Navigator, Vincent Ward, is a young filmmaker with very specific ideas about how he wants his film to look and sound. And I spoke to him this week about Davoud Tabrizi's music in the film, among other things.
With the composer, Davoud Tabrizi, I provided him with a whole lot of material, and he had to find his own tradition, which there's very little kind of village, ethnic, Cumbrian folk music that you can find. Most of the medieval music is from the aristocracy, and that's really what I didn't want. So we drew on Gregorian chant and plain song, Scottish military music, so there's a lot of percussion in the film, Celtic folk music, 19th century mining music, because I figured that it would have related way back to the earlier traditions, and also a lot of naive peasant music, and tried to and a little bit of Eastern music because of the Crusades. It had a kind of influence on the folk music, English folk music, and try to forge it into its own style. And I was, you know, here's this Iranian composer having to write the lyrics in English and get them translated into Gaelic. I was amazed at just how he managed to get his head around it.
Last time we talked to you on the movie show, you were just about to take The Navigator to the Cannes Film Festival. Can you just tell us what's been happening since then?
Since then, I've been travelling with the film. I've been to about 8 different countries in preparation for its release in those countries, although it will be released in about 25 countries. So I feel a bit like a distributor entering my 5th year on it.
And of course you won the AFI award for the best film, for which congratulations, by the way. I gather that, generally speaking, reactions to the film have been very positive. You sold it to 25 countries. It must have had a very good reaction.
It's had a fantastic response. And it's also, it's had a response with quite different sorts of audiences. So, for example, in Cannes you get, I guess you call this serious entertainment, people that respond to those kind of films. But also it's had a very interesting response at 3 different fantasy film festivals. In fact, it won 3 of them, one in Munich, one in Rome, and one in Seques in Spain. So where in a number of those cases, it's not only judged by jury, but it's also judged by the audience as well. Mm. And that's quite reassuring, because you work on a film for so long and you don't know how it'll go down, and you hope that it'll get a good critical response, but until also it's with an audience, you don't know whether the punters will like it.
Given the premise of these strangers who arrive out of time, out of place, the fashionable thing to do with that theme these days would be to make them aliens from another planet. Why did you decide to make them medieval time travellers?
Well, I think there's a lot, particularly in Australasia, that comes from a kind of Celtic tradition. And, you know, most of us are of Celtic descent, Irish, Scottish, Welsh. And I like the idea of taking people from a much earlier time, from, say, the 14th century, and bringing them to the 20th, because you would see what had happened in the course of that time. You'd see what was Celtic and what was medieval in the 20th century. And also, there are a lot of comparisons made between the 14th and the 20th. Semiologist Umberto Eco has written a number of essays on as if the 20th century is like a new medieval time in decline. And the historian Barbara Tuckman has written a history book on the 14th century called A Distant Mirror. So there are very often comparisons between those two times.
What sort of comparisons then do you see?
In terms of potential for annihilation, is a real comparison. And in the 14th, you had almost 2/3 of Europe being wiped out by the Black Death. So in my story, I've drawn an analogy between 2 smaller pockets in the Pacific. The one in the 14th century, a small little village fending off the Black Death, and the one in the 20th century worried about trying to affect its fate in terms of the nuclear situation.
Do you consider yourself then an obsessive director?
Probably, yeah. I mean, when I'm making a film, you kind of become engulfed by it. But I try to forget about it afterwards. It's kind of like you're so submerged in the story and you're working blinkered that at the end of it you surface and you look around, it's like your head popping out of a hole and you're kind of a bit surprised that there's a world going on around you.
Oh, God.